Renny's life.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the 14th lecture series of which is presented by AOI, our PG lecture series, which has been extremely popular. We've had more than 2,500 registrations and something that is eagerly looked forward every Wednesday. Today, the topic is on allergic rhinitis, vasomotor rhinitis, immunotherapy, and nasal polyposis. So in our daily practice, we come across a large number of patients with allergic rhinitis, but this is a topic that is not given due justice in the medical colleges. So we do not have dedicated clinics in most of the medical colleges. So to enlighten us on this topic, today we have two very popular, famous allergy specialists from the country, Dr. Sarika Verma and Dr. Ashim Desai. And we also have Dr. Deepak Haldipur, our AOI past president, who will be addressing us on nasal polyposis. The moderators for the evening are two equally eminent ENT surgeons who have a special interest in allergic rhinitis. Dr. Subir Jain from Indore, besides his regular ENT practice, he has special interest in allergic rhinitis, and he has addressed more than 150 lectures on this topic across the country. He has also delivered the Dr. Ashok Gupta lecture at the RhinoCon. He has several papers on research work in allergic rhinitis in slit therapy. He has presented this at various conferences, various European conference, the World Allergy Congress, etc. He also has teaching videos and DVDs on why and how to treat allergic rhinitis. He has a YouTube channel which, besides allergic rhinitis, also tackles other different topics for public awareness. Welcome, Dr. Subir Jain. Our next moderator for the evening is Dr. Rupali Jain. She is a practicing ENT surgeon with a special interest in allergy diagnosis and treatment in the Varud district, Amravati. Since the last 18 years, she has been practicing over there. And as we all know, in fact, we have heard her a number of times on various medico-legal seminars. So she has a special interest in medico-legal dealings as well, and is a medico-legal consultant with the legal firm Jay & Company, Mumbai. Welcome, Dr. Rupali. So with this, I hand over to Dr. Subir Jain to introduce our speakers for the evening.
Thank you so much, Dr. Samir. It's a wonderful evening, and the topics are of great interest. And as you elaborated, that allergic rhinitis is one of the very important topic. And today, we have got eminent speakers in the form of Dr. Sarika Verma and Dr. Ashim Desai. Both are going to cover different aspects of allergic rhinitis. Our first speaker is Dr. Sarika Verma. She is very well known to me since years together now, and we both are very good friends and discussing all aspects of allergic rhinitis and its treatment modalities. Dr. Sarika Verma is an ENT surgeon and allergy specialist based in Gurgaon. She did MBBS from Kilpok Medical College, DLO from Madras Medical College, and DNB from Sir Ganga Ram Hospital, New Delhi. She awarded the All India Gold Medal by National Board of Examinations in year 2005. She has worked in Sir Ganga Ram, Apollo, Max, Fortis, Artemis Hospital before launching a chain of ENT and allergy clinics called Allergy Doc, with multiple centers in Gurgaon, Delhi, Mumbai, Udaipur, and Chandigarh. So this is really wonderful to listen and to get knowledge about allergic and vasomotor rhinitis from Dr. Sarika Verma. First, we are going to cover this allergic and vasomotor rhinitis. Dr. Sarika is going to enlighten on that. Afterwards, Dr. Ashim Desai will be speaking on skin prick test and immunotherapy. So I welcome Dr. Sarika Verma. Please enlighten on allergic and vasomotor rhinitis. Dr. Sarika Verma.
Thank you so much, sir. I'll just share my screen. Can you see that?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, first and foremost, I would like to thank Dr. Sameer Bhargav and the entire team of AOI for having me here. This is one of the most prestigious platforms to speak in ENT in India, and I'm really delighted to be here. Dr. Sudhir has already given my introduction. I have been working in allergy for 2 decades now. It's something that's very close to my heart. And I hope that by the end of this lecture, you will have at least 1 or 2 points that you can use in your regular practice and make a difference to your patients. So when you have a patient who comes in with excessive sneezing, blocked nose, watery nose, and so with a lot of itching in the nose. So most of the time, the diagnosis is very clear to you. You know that you're dealing with an allergic rhinitis. We also have to look for other symptoms, and sometimes you have to ask the patient because they may not be upfront about it if they have any itching or watering or redness in their eyes. And in such patients, we must always inquire and in detail a history of asthma, bronchitis, and hyperreactive airway disease, which includes breathlessness, choking episodes, wheezing sounds, cough, and whether or not at some point they have been using an inhaler or a nebulizer. This is very important to us because in allergic rhinitis and asthma are coexistent conditions, and almost 80% of asthmatics have allergic rhinitis, and about 20% of patients with allergic rhinitis have asthma. That's because the airway has a remodeling. The area has given the concept of a single airway, single disease. That is the ciliated mucus, the ciliated columnar epithelial that is lining our nose is also lining the lungs. And if they have an allergy and that's untreated, there's an inflammation, and it causes tissue remodeling and makes the airway hyperreactive, the muscles constrict, and the mucosa thickens, thus causing a baseline inflammation and hyperreactive airway disease. So we must ask every patient who comes to you with symptoms of sneezing, watery nose, blocked nose, etc. You must spend at least 10 minutes asking them about their history. Most of the time, they have already taken anti-allergic from their GP. They have taken nasal sprays from the chemist. So they know what works and what doesn't. But what we need to do is delve into their history, find out what is wrong, and try to find the diagnosis so that we're able to give them a long-term cure. So we need to ask them if there's a specific time of onset. Did it start in the pollen season? Did it start after taking some antibiotic? Did it start after a viral infection? Many patients will give you a history that it started after an episode of pneumonia, or whether it has been there since childhood. So these are important things that you must ask every patient. We also have to ask the duration of disease, whether it has been there for a few weeks, few months, few years. That is very important because that helps us decide on our line of action for the patient. Also, an important thing to ask is a medication requirement. What medicine are they on? Are they taking antihistamine? How many days in a week do they take that medicine? Are they on an inhaler? How many times a week or how many times in a month? In a year, how many times have they needed to nebulize? These are important questions. They give us a very quantitative idea about the severity of disease. And later on, we can use it to analyze how much improvement is there after the treatment has been started. And the most important factor which decides what we are going to do with this patient is the impact on quality of life. If a patient has a mild disease, an intermittent disease, and they say, no, we are okay with it, jada farak nahi padta, then you don't have to really be investigating or treating it. But if a patient says that every morning they wake up with a sneezing, or they are taking anti-allergic 20 days in a month, then that is definitely something, and that it impacts their going out and it affects their school and work, then definitely we need to treat them more aggressively. So this area has given us this beautiful classification, and that is what you must use for every patient. You have to, after taking a history, you know whether it is less than 4 days a week, less than 4 weeks in a year, then it is called intermittent allergic rhinitis. And persistent if it is more than 4 days in a week or more than 4 weeks in a year. Also, then they are further classified both the categories into mild, moderate and severe. Mild is when there is no impairment of sleep and no impairment in the daily activities and sports, leisure, etc. And if the patient says that they're not able to sleep or they're not able to go to attend their sports class or not able to go to run or they have to miss work days and from school or from office, then that means it's a severe or moderate to severe disease. Every patient must be asked about a history of family allergies, because a family history of allergies, like one parent or both parents, grandparents, siblings, and also mamas, chachas. So that gives us a very good idea about how it's going to impact their life. So if there is none of the parents have an allergy, the child has a 15% chance of being allergic. If one parent is allergic, you have a 20 to 40% chance. And if both parents are allergic, there's a 60 to 80% chance of the child being allergic. I have two or three children who have very severe atopy because both their parents are allergic. So this is something that we will need to treat very aggressively and early on. We will not be casual with these children. We need to treat them very aggressively. We also have to ask them for any other allergy, like a skin allergy, rash, urticaria, angioedema. Sometimes you may have a swelling of your lips or eyelid. And I have seen a couple of uvular edemas. So these are allergies that you will need to inquire, because patients will not be forthcoming. And you have to ask them what if they have any other symptoms like that. Also, we need to ask them for a food allergy, history of food allergy. 9 foods are responsible for 90% of the food allergies. Most of these include nuts, vegetables, milk, dairy milk products, and shrimp, prawns, etc. So these are things that if you ask and if they have a correlation, then elimination of these foods can make a huge impact on the quality of life of these patients. So differential diagnosis, when you have a patient with rhinitis, in your mind you have to classify whether this sounds like an allergic or whether it is a non-allergic. Sometimes you have patients who give you very specific things, like ladies, they'll say that around their periods they may get allergy. Allergic symptoms, or somebody says that every time I have spicy food, I develop gustatory rhinitis. So these are things that we will also need to eliminate before we classify the patient as allergic. So there are various phenotypes and endotypes. A rhinitis is divided into allergic rhinitis, which is the largest subset, and infectious rhinitis, which I'm not going to cover today, and non-allergic rhinitis, which I'm going to say, give a few slides about. But these phenotypes are dynamic and they may overlap and develop one into the other. So they're a little vague. It's not as if a patient who has only gustatory rhinitis may not have allergic rhinitis. They may have both. And you need to identify and treat both these simultaneously. So there's an overlap of these phenotypes and endotypes. As you can see, allergic rhinitis is IgE-mediated inflammation. It's a very specific subset. And then you have neurogenic allergic rhinitis, like gustatory rhinitis, occupational rhinitis. There are patients who say that Monday to Friday they have symptoms, but Saturday, Sunday or holidays they remain all right. Irritant-induced gastritis, if they are going to a factory or plant, especially the paints and the watch company, the patients who work there. So we need to have a very detailed history about what is their line of work, when do the symptoms occur. And rhinitis of the elderly is very problematic. Sometimes it can be drug induced. Sometimes it's also localized, like non-allergic rhinitis with eosinophilia. So if you treat the eosinophilia, then the symptoms disappear. So those are things that we can identify and tackle. And so the patient doesn't have to be on a long-term treatment. Allergic rhinitis, of course, is an inflammatory process of the nasal mucosa. Typically, it is IgE mediated. And these triggers are environmental allergens, and almost always it is a protein. Suppose you have patients with allergy, I mean, when their symptoms get worse with temperature or with chemicals or pollution. So pollution is an irritant. It is not an allergy. So if you have a lot of times we see these blood test reports that says allergic to smoke, allergic to perfume. These things are simply not possible to test because these are not proteins. So IgE-mediated allergy is always to a protein substance, and they are usually natural substances. Of course, processed foods, chemicals, pollutants, all of them act as irritants, and they may predispose a patient to showing an allergic phenotype. And typically we have inflammatory cells. If you take a nasal smear, you will find eosinophilia. And allergic rhinitis has classic symptoms of excessive sneezing, watery nose, nasal blockage, itching, and may be associated with conjunctivitis. There are two sets of patients. One is blockers and one is runners. Some of them have more nasal blockage, more at night. And some patients who have a lot of sneezing with excessive nasal itching. So we can also classify them as blockers and runners and then treat them accordingly, depending on what their primary symptom is. So then coming to the non-allergic rhinitis, so drug-induced rhinitis, like rhinitis medicamentosa, I'm sure all of you have patients in your practice who've been taking xylometazoline and oxymetazoline drops for years and years. So they cause dependence, it causes blockage. So if they do not take the medicine, they're not able to sleep at night. So we have to treat it like a drug, literally like a drug, because it causes severe dependence. And rhinitis medicamentosa needs a lot of discussion with the patient. We have to counsel them, we have to spend a lot of time, and then gradually we are able to wean them off. But it needs a lot of willpower on the patient's side. Gustatory rhinitis, if your patient may say that every time they sit down to eat, they develop rhinitis, or it may be a particular food like a spicy food that causes rhinitis. So some patient will tell you that every time they eat a food, then they have to go and blow the nose. So that's typically gustatory rhinitis. Hormone-induced rhinitis, including rhinitis of pregnancy. Non-allergic rhinitis with eosinophilia. Senile rhinitis, with a growing age, we are facing a lot of patients in their 70s and 80s who come to you with symptoms like dry mouth or running nose or a post-nasal discharge, and you have to treat them symptomatically. Atrophic rhinitis is, of course, primary ENT, and non-allergic rhinitis or vasomotor rhinitis. Especially patients say that in the AC temperature, their allergy symptoms get worse, or in winter, the symptoms get worse. We just have to do an allergy test by skin prick method, rule out that this is not allergic, and only then that we can classify them as vasomotor rhinitis. Vasomotor rhinitis is fairly challenging for ENTs to treat. But fortunately, their incidence is fairly low. 1 out of 1,000 patients of allergic rhinitis. I mean, the ratio is about 1 VMR to about 1,000 pure non-allergic rhinitis. So that's, we are grateful that it's not as much, because it's a very big challenge to treat these patients. The diagnosis, of course, with a detailed history. Anti-rhinoscopy, you will see pale turbinates, boggy inferior, pale mucosa, boggy inferior turbinates. You have to rule out whether there's a sharp spur or a gross DNS which is causing a nasal blockage. We have to look for nasal polyps. If you find that the patient may be having nasal polyps or small mucoid thing, you can do a diagnostic nasal endoscopy. And chest auscultation is compulsory. So every ENT should have a stent in their chamber. If you have a patient with allergic rhinitis, always, always, always auscultate their chest. Look for a wheeze. Because a lot of times these patients think that the breathlessness is because of nasal blockage. But when you auscultate, you will find a wheeze. And these bronchi are very classic, and you can obviously give them bronchodilators and then give them good relief. And if you leave it untreated, of course, you're endangering the patient. So a basic test like a CBC, eosinophil count, absolute eosinophil count, and ESR will give us a rough idea of whether the eosinophil count is raised and they need to be given a course of Etrazone. Allergy test by skin prick method, this will be covered by Dr. Ashim, so I'm not talking about this. Serum IG total, a lot of physicians you will find send you patients with the IG raised. But sometimes we have also seen that the patient may be highly allergic, but the IG is normal. So IG is total IG is not an absolute test. It may or may not have a correlation with skin prick testing. Essentially, at the end, it has to be the patient's symptoms that decide the diagnosis. Serum-specific IG, of course, is a very good tool that in patients who cannot undergo skin prick test because they are not able to stop anti-allergics, or if they have burns and scars in their forearms and back, or if they have dermatographism. That means if you touch the skin and they develop a rash, then that means we will not be able to get an accurate analysis on a skin prick test. Those patients can undergo a serum-specific IgE test. It's an expensive blood test. In a good lab, it costs between 12 to 18,000 rupees. Each panel is tested. But these days, we are getting a lot of this fake kind of testing in which in 4,000 rupees or 2,000 rupees, they test for 250 things and they give you a report. Those reports are useless. They are a waste of the patient's money. They are a waste of your time and effort, because there is no correlation between the patient symptoms and the things. The other day, I had a patient who had got a test done, and she was positive to, she was shown positive to allergic to 50 foods. So that stopped her from eating almost everything. So some doctor had referred her to me, and I did a skin prick test. She was allergic only to 2 foods. So the skin prick test is the final word, and I'll leave that topic to Dr. Ashim. Component testing is also available. These are in a few labs, but it's not available extensively. Component testing means a certain elements of the antigen can be tested. Like, for example, house dust mite, you have certain proteins, and cat, you can have certain proteins which are tested. That's called component testing. That makes your treatment even more accurate. So essentially, our challenge is not just to make a diagnosis and leave it, because it's not academic. Every patient who comes to your clinic must get better because he has met you, he or she has met you. So effective treatment and management is the big challenge. And whether you go in for allergy testing or immunotherapy, the first and foremost treatment will always be the medical management. So when you have identified the phenotype, and then you need to give specific treatments. So if there's a structural blockage, then of course the patient needs to undergo surgery. If it is idiopathic rhinitis, intranasal corticosteroids may be tried. If they don't work, capsaicin spray can work. Gustatory rhinitis, we need to identify what they're allergic to, may avoid it. And if not, then we can also try experimentally intranasal anticholinergics and capsaicin spray. Rhinitis of pregnancy is very problematic, especially in the last trimester, because of the increased progesterone and levels, and it can cause severe bogginess. So these patients are very uncomfortable. The one thing we must remember as a rule is they should not be given oxymetazoline and decongestant. Local decongestants should not be given, because sometimes they can trigger premature labor. So preterm labor can happen because you put the drops. So ensure that no pregnant lady is given oxymetazoline in your watch. Right? Other than that, you can give them intranasal corticosteroids. Multiple drugs have been, efficacy is only proven for budesonide, but clinically, we have seen that mometasone is given safely, and it, the patients take it very well. We can also tell the patient to take an antihistamine like cetirizine, which is safe, and loratadine once the second trimester. You can also give them loratadine safely. And these patients do well with steam inhalation, and you have to counsel them, tell them that this is because of the raised hormones and it will become all right. Rhinitis medicamentosa, we've already discussed. We have to stop this the medicine. That is the only thing, and we have to do a lot of counseling. Allergic rhinitis, I'll be talking to you in more detail. Atrophic rhinitis, sometimes you need to give them antibiotics. You may need to do a smear and see. And of course, nasal hygiene, saline rinses. You can give, we used to give these glycerin drops, medicated glycerin drops when we were in medical college. And worst case scenario, you may need to do a surgery, close the nasal space so that the atrophy can heal itself and the mucosa can become normal. You have to ensure that whatever factor has caused the atrophic rhinitis, whether it was medicine or whether it was a drug that they were using, that must go, because unless that is taken care of, you're going to have a recurrence. Senile rhinitis works well with intranasal anticholinergics, can be tried. Drug-induced rhinitis, we need to discontinue the aspirin. We need to discontinue the drug, and intranasal corticosteroids can be tried. Aspirin desensitization is mentioned, but it's a very difficult technique, and we need to do have the patient in the ICU, where we have to give them gradually increasing doses of aspirin, as much as 2,400 grams or milligrams of aspirin. So that's not an easy process, but if necessary, maybe. NAERS, you can try intranasal corticosteroid, but when eosinophilia, always treat the eosinophilia with a 3-week course of Hetrazone and Zentel as a for deworming once today and once after 2 weeks. That takes care of the eosinophilia to a very large extent. And occupational rhinitis, we need to classify them as allergic and non-allergic. And if it's possible, avoidance is the best thing. You can give them a medical certificate, tell them to be in a different department for 3 to 4 months. And if they're absolutely fine, then you can probably ask them to change their job or their field. Even inside that same office, they may do that. So these are practical things that you have to be very specific about and find out what they are allergic to. Now coming to allergic rhinitis, the general overview about area is given is that, of course, environment control, wherever feasible, you need to find out if it is an insect, then you need to give them insect repellent sprays. If it is house dust mite, first and foremost, we have to give them house dust mite avoidance measures. And if it is a pollen season, then you can tell the patient that either if you are going out for a walk in the park, then they can wear a mask. So these are things that wherever feasible, we need to do an environmental control. And if possible, we can ask them to give the either buy if they have the wherewithal. The cost is a very important thing. Then they can buy mattress covers, which are house dust mite proof. And these are expensive, but they're available in India. And that's something that we can do. Pharmacotherapy remains the mainstay of treatment, and I'll be speaking more in detail. Immunotherapy is the final word on how we treat allergies. So in patients who have a long-term issue and when we need intervention, then we do immunotherapy. Immunotherapy will also be covered by my senior colleague, Dr. Ashim. So I will not be talking about this. And patient education, that is, of course, the key. And when you test for patient, the skin prick testing, you find there is a food, then you need to tell them to eliminate those foods as well. So medical management is pharmacological management. I'll just be speaking about each of these. Intranasal corticosteroids are the drug of choice for allergic rhinitis. And for patients with nasal polyps, you will have to tell them that they have to take intranasal corticosteroids for the rest of their life. This is something that many of our senior colleagues also forget. But when you have done a FES for nasal polyps, to ensure there is no recurrence, you must put the patient on steroids and nasal wash for the rest of their life so that the polyps don't come back. Otherwise, we see recurrence in as early as 3 months. And these are very safe for long-term usage. There is no dependence and very less systemic absorption. There are only a couple of drugs like budesonide, which can cause glaucoma. So you have to use budesonide on long-term basis with caution. But other than that, fluticasone and mometasone are very safe. There's no systemic absorption. And they improve all the symptoms of allergic rhinitis, whether it is nasal blockage or sneezing. So when the patient responds well to intranasal corticosteroid, that's sort of diagnostic that, yeah, there is allergic rhinitis. So intranasal antihistamines, they're very effective in relieving the sneezing and nasal itching. They can be given alone. Now we have a couple of companies which are making azelastin as an isolated spray. This I find a wonderful drug for patients who come with acute rhinitis and severe rhinitis, and they are very uncomfortable. You can give azelastin alone, and that spray can be used 3 to 4 times a day, and sometimes even every 2 hours for acute rhinitis. It works beautifully. Maybe in 2 or 3 days time, then you can taper the medicine. And in combination with intranasal corticosteroid, they can be used for a long term. But they have a bitter aftertaste. I would recommend that you don't use it for children, because if in a child you put a spray which is bitter, the next time you'll spend half an hour running after the child, but they will never get the spray done. So mometasone works very nicely in children. One, because it has a lovely taste. So I've tried it myself and I use it on my children, and this taste is like quite pleasant. And I would advise that, and I do this for all my patients, you must personally demonstrate to each patient how to put a nasal spray. That is the key. You have to tell them to bend forward, keep their mouth open and keep breathing through the mouth. And put the spray turned towards the ear or the eye of the same side. One puff here, one puff here. And tell the patient to sit forward, lean forward and breathe with their mouth open, and not to sniff it in. The patient must not sniff the intranasal steroid or antihistamine inside, because once the effect is in the nasal mucosa, if it goes into the nasopharynx or oropharynx, it is not helping the allergic rhinitis, and it is certainly going to give them a very bad taste. So that reduces our compliance to a very large extent. So if you take 1 minute, when you prescribe a spray, take 30 seconds to show the patient how to put the spray, and that you will find that the compliance improves very well. Oral antihistamines are the mainstay, whether they can be given alone in mild allergic rhinitis or in combination with intranasal corticosteroids. You must always choose the least sedative option. Fexofenadine, loratadine, bilastine are the main drugs which are totally non-sedative. They are safe for pilots to fly a plane. Other drugs are also there. Cetirizine is one of the oldest drugs. It is safest in children below 6 years of age, but it is quite sedative. So if, as long as they are not sedated, then you can give them. And pregnancy, of course, we've already discussed. Leukotriene receptor antagonists, they are very effective as a step-up therapy. If an intranasal corticosteroid and an oral antihistamine is not working alone, then you can add Montelukast. But you must always remember to step down. This is a step-up therapy. That means after about 2 to 4 weeks, you're going to call the patient back, and then you must remember to step it down to a plain antihistamine. In combination with antihistamines, they work beautifully when the airway is involved. So when you have a patient with hyperreactive airway disease or bronchitis, yeah, I love to use a fexofenadine and a Montelukast combination. Works very well, and usually I give it for 4 weeks. Recommended dosage is not more than 6 weeks. We have, I'm sure all of you have seen that you have patients coming from the pediatrician who are on Montelukast for 6 years and Montelukast for several years. So I have found that this is not a very good thing, but we must educate more people, especially our colleagues, that this is not recommended more than 6 weeks. There's a very important paper from NHS which came that said that there are neuropsychiatric effects on children, including suicidal tendencies. So Montelukast should be used with caution and use only for the recommended duration. And I have in several patients found that withdrawal happens, and the patients develop excessive sneezing, itching in their skin whenever you stop the Montelukast with levocetirizine combination. So I would use this with a little caution and see that you don't give it for forever and ever. Plain antihistamines work better in long term. Add-ons, you can add decongestants, which may be oral. Decongestants can be used as a combination, but with care, because in hypertensive or anybody with a heart disease, they can cause palpitations. Local decongestants can be used, but for a very short duration. You must try it not more than 3 to 5 days. Use with caution. Saline nasal wash gel neti, it removes the mucus and it helps the spray to reach the sinuses well. Steam inhalation always works. Chromolomes can be used. Intranasal anticholinergics can be tried experimentally, especially non-allergic rhinitis. Ipratropium is available as a nebulizer. And capsaicin spray, I have not personally used it, but I've heard that it works very well. Oral steroids must be used only when the patient is not responding to therapy. It should be a short dosage. So stepwise algorithm we've just discussed, which I'm going to go a little fast now because I think I'm running out of my 3 minutes left. And approach to allergic rhinitis is a step-up approach. Antihistamine, oral or nasal, add a nasal corticosteroid, add antihistamines, leukotriene receptor antagonist. Step up with nasal douching, avoiding the triggers, and immunotherapy if necessary, and you step down when the patient is better. The burden of allergy is huge, and these are percentages across the world, and it is a global public health issue, and allergies have increased over the last 4 decades. Now it's almost 20 to 30% of Indians suffer from allergies at some point in their life. So this is a huge burden of treatment. There's an atopic march. Ketani et al. Gave this concept. And they said that, you know, allergies change with time. So children who develop atopy in the beginning may develop asthma and rhinitis as they go along. So we must intervene early in children. Do a skin prick test. If it is house dust mite, you start immunotherapy early. And you can avoid certain foods like milk, egg, etc. So that their eczema gets controlled and they don't become asthmatics or develop allergic rhinitis by the time they're older. So this is the way this progresses. There's a genetic predisposition. There is environmental risk factors. They cause childhood eczema. The defective skin barrier causes an increase in allergen entry, and there's epicutaneous sensitization. And they become, on re-exposure to allergens, then they develop allergic rhinitis or asthma. So the take-home message is only one. Allergy is treatable. Whether you treat it with tablet, whether you treat it with spray, whether you treat it with allergy testing, or whether you treat it with immunotherapy, please treat your allergy patients and let them remain symptom-free with or without medicine. Thank you so much. I hope I have not extended my time. Dr. Subir?
Yeah?
You can switch on your camera.
Camera was, All right, now it's okay, fine. Fantastic, Dr. Sarika. You covered each and every aspect in a fantastic manner. All it's a nutshell. Agar Hindi mein bole to gagar mein sagar. That's really wonderful. Very nicely covered.
Short duration, no, I wanted to just highlight the point.
You got only 30 minutes, and in 30 minutes you covered allergic rhinitis, vasomotor rhinitis, and treatment protocols. That's really good. Very nice. Whosoever has attended this must be benefited. That's really wonderful. I would request all the persons, all the doctors who are attending this session, please keep your questions ready and put your questions, so that at the end, now Dr. Ashim will be addressing after Dr. Ashim's deliberation, we will have question answer session on allergy. Fine. So now I would like to invite Dr. Ashim Desai. And first I would like to introduce Dr. Ashim Desai. He has done MS in ENT from Mumbai, DORL in ENT from Bombay, same. Trained at the KEM Hospital and Municipal ENT Hospital, obtained specialized training in the field of middle ear and mastoid surgery at the House Ear Institute in USA, and at the University Hospital in Zurich under Dr. Hugo Fish. Dr. Ashim is a versatile person, but he has got a very special interest in the field of otologic surgery for adults and pediatric deafness, especially the cochlear implantation. Sleep surgery also is one of the field where he is interested, and he do sleep surgeries also, management of sleep related breathing disorders mainly, and functional and aesthetic surgery of the nose. So, and he is also interested in allergy and immunotherapy. So he has got a very wide field of ENT, practically all fields he is covering, and he has a very special interest in allergy and immunology. He is CEO at Dr. ABR Desai ENT Clinic and Research Center at Mumbai, invited as guest faculty at many regional, national and international workshops, invited speaker at AOI conferences and ISO conferences. Dr. Ashim Desai has also established a healthcare technology startup. Now, may I invite Dr. Ashim Desai to speak on skin prick test and immunotherapy. Dr. Ashim Desai.
Thank you very much, Subirji. It's a pleasure, honor and privilege to be here today. I think the host has to start my video. I cannot start my video. I think they don't want to see my face here. So, but okay. Now I think I will be able to start my video. That's perfect.
Yeah, great.
So thank you very much, Sameer. Thank you. I would express my special thanks for this initiative by the AOI under Sameer's able guidance to enable this series of video lectures, and it is really excellent. I've really enjoyed it so far, and I'm sure that many, many more good ones are going to be coming. So once again, very special thanks to you, Sameer, and the whole organizing committee of AOI. So the topic I have been asked to speak on is, one moment, again, my video has disappeared, is the management of allergic rhinitis, the diagnostics and the immunotherapy. Now, if I can share my screen, I will just get this started. Do you have the picture? Subir, do we have the picture now?
Yeah, we are getting it, yeah.
Okay, thank you. So, you know that forever as good ENT surgeons, we are striving in our quest to do our best. However, we are missing on a fundamental issue that will help our sinus patients and our allergic patients, and that's the precise diagnosis of allergy and its treatment. There are a lot of myths and mysteries attached to this, and I have seen even today in 2020 and 2019 that doctors are even yet not accepting the importance of allergy in our practice. As Sameer very correctly said, it has not been given its due place in the sun. And it's wonderful that Subir and Sarika and Rupali and so on, so many of you are taking so much interest in this. And it's wonderful that this topic is now being given its due relevance. So my aim is to present today the logic, the thinking, the scientific evidence, and the basis for precise allergy testing and immunotherapy. And I also wish to introduce the concept of precision medicine for upper airway and otolaryngologic allergy. So we are often faced with whether we should only continue with pharmacotherapy, whether we should consider allergy testing, if so, what testing, whether we should do immunotherapy. Now, what happens here is that we have to understand that pharmacotherapy, immunotherapy go hand in hand. The thing here is that yin, it's literally the yin and yang, as in Chinese mythology of yin and yang, which is creating the whole. And it is pharmacotherapy and immunotherapy are complementary rather than opposing forces. And it is my aim today to help you establish where to use immunotherapy and where to use pharmacotherapy. Because always remember that the whole is greater than the parts. Be that as it may, it is evident that all the evidence points towards the inadequacy of allergy diagnosis and therapy in our country. And till yesterday, initially we started with pharmacotherapy and then straight away went into surgery if pharmacotherapy failed. But there is certainly a better way to treat allergies. And the idea is not just to treat the symptoms with our pharmacotherapy, but to treat the cause. So many of us are guilty of continuously using months and months of anti-leukotriene agents, antihistaminics, steroids, steroid sprays, inhaled corticosteroids. But even in children, there are many papers that, did you know that continuous use of inhalers and corticosteroid sprays causes growth retardation in children? It can cause. There are two or three studies that show that. So there must be a better way to treat it. And I really appreciate the AOI forum here, in which you have better understanding of the anatomy and the disease. The focus is on evidence-based medicine, improving results, and therefore enhancing our practices. As Sarika earlier mentioned, do we need allergy testing? When you consider that 30 crore Indians have significant allergy, as per the WHO, about 20 to 30% of the population has allergic disorders in India. I think that allergy testing is an absolute must. Because after all, we have two schools of thought. One is to do nothing, give antihistaminics and steroid, and if that doesn't work, let us operate. And the second one is to do something, that is to attempt the testing and allergy immunotherapy. And of course, there are two schools of thoughts, and if two people agreed on everything, one of them is absolutely unnecessary. But the question I ask all of us is that if it were our child, what would I do? Would I keep him or her on chronic use of antihistaminic steroids, anti-leukotrienes? Especially today, you have seen the new FDA guidelines regarding leukotrienes for long-term causing neuropsychiatric effects. Or would I consider doing the correct form of testing and immunotherapy? The evidence here is very clear that uncontrolled allergic rhinitis leads to worsening of coexistent asthma, and treatment of allergic rhinitis improves asthma. And in both of these, long-term relief of inflammation is important for the management of both of these disorders. So we are aware that patients with allergic rhinitis are three times more likely to subsequently develop asthma. And if treatment is started early, asthma can be prevented. And this was well outlined by Sarika a little bit earlier, that the allergic march should be arrested in whatever way possible. Another sad scenario is that 70% of allergy sufferers, our sinus sufferers, are actually suffering from allergy. Because if allergen exposure persists, a chronic inflammation occurs, and allergy itself predisposes the patient to develop frequent and more severe URTI. Why is that so? Because allergies upregulate receptors for all the viruses. Couple of things I need you to understand is that upregulation of intercellular adhesion molecule 1 receptors predispose to increased susceptibility of respiratory tissues to rhinovirus A and B. And upregulation of cadherin type receptor 3 predisposes to increased susceptibility of respiratory viruses to rhinovirus C and other viruses. Now, so you can see that viral infections, recurrent URTI, occurs in patients with allergic rhinitis with increased frequency. So, of course, adenoids are also in many cases consequential to allergies. And we often find that even after doing a perfect adenoidectomy, patients come back with nasal blockage and so on and so forth. And in such cases, appropriate desensitization seems to help in the long run. So the basic principles of treatment, of course, have been well elucidated, but I will go more into the diagnosis of allergy, because the principles of treatment is that minimal persistent inflammation is an underlying cause of chronicity, and this is the most neglected aspect of allergy management. It is also very important to continue therapy, such as immunotherapy, for a prolonged period of times, up to 3 years or more, to allow the allergic response to subside. And the logic is that you want to reduce the allergic load, to reduce the chronic inflammation to below the symptom thresholds. So the diagnosis, the precise diagnosis of allergy is often done by skin prick testing. That is the commonest way. Some people perform specific IgE testing. Nowadays, component testing has started to come into vogue. There must be made a mention of specific IgG also. And of course, total IgE is to be mentioned to be condemned as a pure method of allergy diagnosis. Total IgE should not be the sole method by which you diagnose allergic rhinitis or asthma. In addition to this, the latest that is coming out is what is known as basophil activation tests. And this is done with molecular allergens, and not only does it identify the allergen the patient is IgE sensitized to, but also the allergenic activity of these specific IgE antibodies. This is the last word in diagnosis of allergy today. I will come to all of this in a short while. And of course, the gold standard for food allergy is a food challenge test, and gold standard for environmental allergy is the environmental chamber tests. That, of course, is not often done in India, but I'm just mentioning for the sake of completion. As Sarika mentioned earlier, the RAS tests are now no longer accepted. So skin prick test today is regarded as the gold standard for allergy testing in North America, Canada, the world over. And allergic skin prick tests is an essential part of the evaluation, diagnosis, and treatment of allergic disease, as per all the known journals and known allergy organizations that exist. So everybody says that skin prick test remains the gold standard for the detection of allergen-specific IgE. So this is the evidence in front of you, because after all, evidence-based medicine is what we must all practice. So today we do conclude that SPTs are the most accurate way to test allergies. Now, when you are doing this, first and foremost, it is very important to stop the antihistaminics and steroids and painkillers at least 4 days before the procedure, minimum 3 days. Generally, the forearms are used, and in males, you are asked to come with the shared forearms. Clinically relevant testing is a must. There are two ways of testing. One is a top-down and bottom-up approach. The top-down approach is take a careful clinical history and then do the clinically relevant testing of the clinically relevant allergens. And bottom-up approach is that you first do all the allergy tests and then try to find out which are correlating clinically. Both are done, both are performed, both are accepted. You have to choose what you wish to follow. But the most important thing is that positive histamine and negative saline control is a must. Why is that so? Because unless you have a positive histamine control, you will not be able to identify true allergy, because allergy, after all, is a histamine-based thing. And if you have a skin condition, such as dermographia, the saline control will also show positivity, and therefore you should not be doing the allergy test. So this positive histamine and negative saline control is a must. Droplets of allergens are placed, the lancet held at 45 degrees, and the skin is raised without drawing blood. Interpretation after 20 minutes. And you can see that each and every one of these points, no blood is drawn. The moment you start drawing blood, that means you've gone into the dermis, subdermal layers, and that's not a good and appropriate way of doing the test. A lot of people are scared of anaphylactic reactions, but this is an absolutely, I have never seen a case of anaphylaxis in the last 25 years that I've been practicing allergy. I started allergy testing diagnostics in the first year of my practice, that's 1994, until today, I've never seen a single case of anaphylaxis. What I do see sometimes is the fact that sometimes a patient can get a vasovagal attack, and then you must be prepared for that by making the patient lie down and giving him or her sufficient supportive methods. So we will go into that. There's a small video of skin prick testing, which we can go into later if we have the time. But I want to discuss first the limitations of skin prick testing. The first limitation is that skin conditions like severe atopic dermatitis or dermographia will preclude skin prick testing. chronic use of steroids and antihistaminic use, such as patients who cannot do without even a day, there is no way that you can do skin prick testing because you need to stop these elements before you do it. Polysensitized patients, how to diagnose that, I'll come to in a short while. Food allergies have a limited value, as SPT has a limited value for the diagnosis of food allergies, and sometimes children will not allow us to do skin prick testing. So in all of these are the limitations where skin prick testing cannot be done or should be augmented with something else. But it's important that you use the relevant allergen for your skin prick testing, because there are so many international companies selling oak tree and birch tree and elm tree which do not exist in India. And then how do you expect to find out the true allergy to such products? So the allergens should be relevant to the Indian condition. Sometimes doctors get scared of this SPT. They say that, listen, you've done the SPT, too many allergens are found, and therefore we find it not relevant. But that's not true, because what we need to do is correlate. Clinical correlation is a must. There are some elements which are cross-reactive to each other. And sometimes in polysensitized patients, you must consider component testing. What is component testing? I'll come to shortly. And that's very important to make sure that you diagnose true allergy, because ultimately the aim that we have is proper, absolutely perfect, precise diagnosis. So when you go to the blood allergy diagnosis, you can also do a specific IgE, that is an immunocap, or an Alex, which is a multiplex procedure. What is that? When is it relevant? Because sometimes multiple sensitivities can cause confusion while prescribing immunotherapy. Immunotherapy can only be guided by correct differentiation between sensitivity and true allergy. And for this, component result diagnostics are absolutely important. And although multiple proteins in the substance can cause a positive skin test, the body reacts only to major allergens. So sometimes we need to differentiate major and minor allergens. And therefore, molecular allergy tests, that's the latest cutting edge, can define the true major allergens from the minor allergens, thus allowing a conclusive diagnosis. So we spoke about components. This is for the juniors. What are the components? The components in an allergenic source, some allergen proteins are more important than others. These are major allergen, and these are an allergen is referred to as a major allergen if it's recognized by more than 50% of the patients that are sensitized to the source. That is lipid transfer proteins, tropomyosins, and storage proteins. And minor allergens generally do not provoke symptoms, but SPT is positive. Component testing allows us to determine true allergy in cases where there are many, many positive skin prick tests. Positive skin prick tests are due to pan-allergens and cross-reactive carbohydrate determinants. Now, what are pan-allergens? Patients sensitized to pan-allergens frequently show multiple positive IgE results because they have highly cross-reactive minor components and falsely appear to be highly polysensitized. So these minor components are profilins, polycalcins, PR10 proteins. Patients and CCDs. What are CCDs? CCDs also show positive results to extracts, but not to the corresponding molecules. And CCDs, cross-linked, cross-reactive carbohydrate determinants, are glycoproteins which are structurally similar to many, many allergenic sources. And they are also recognized in foreign and may elicit the production of IgE antibodies. But these are clinically insignificant. So this is the conundrum we face when we are doing skin prick testing. There are a small word about specific IgG, because I've seen that regularly being prescribed for food allergies. And many claim that by avoiding elements found in this test, food allergies can be cured. But the reality is that all the major academies have recommended against using IgG testing to diagnose food allergies and sensitivities. So once you diagnose this, the only way to potentially change the natural course of allergic disease is immunotherapy. Now, before we go in detail on how immunotherapy works, let us figure out what is allergy. Allergy, as you know, is a condition, not a disease. And it's an unusual sensitivity which in like amounts do not affect other people when self-tolerance fails or if there is an overreaction to immune stimulation. As you know, the normal response is called the Th1 response, When the antigen reaches the immune system, lymphocytes produce cytokines such as IL-2 and interferon gamma, which direct B lymphocytes to produce IgG4 antibodies. Now, what happens is that certain people are genetically predisposed, which have an IL-4 receptor modification on the B cell that causes class switching to increase IgG production. Normally, B cells produce IgA, IgM, IgG, but with changed IL-4 receptor modification, when higher amount of TH2 cells cause increased production of IL-4 and IL-5, that causes the B cell to switch the class of immunoglobulin production to IgE. The second one is the hygiene hypothesis. As you know, IgE and eosinophils are required to fight helminths. And in modern society, affluent society, Western society, where the helminth burden is less, there is an increased IgE circulating, causing the loading of the mast cell, and early mast cell degranulation is caused. The stages of allergy, one is the sensitization phase, which is the first encounter with the allergen. Allergen is taken up by antigen-presenting cells, dendritic cells in the mucosa and the skin. What are the antigen-presenting cells? They are the macrophages, the B cells, the dendritic cells. These bind with MHC2, major histocompatibility complex 2, on the surface of these antigen-presenting cells, which go and present to the naive T helper cells, which then differentiate to TH2, which is the allergenic, and the naive B cell differentiate into plasma cells. Now, what happens is that the activated TH2 proliferated by increased IL-2, and that is causing self-stimulation. And the TH2 then cells then secrete IL-4, 5, and 13. Always remember these three interleukins, 4, 5, and 13. They're responsible for allergenic symptoms. And these act on B cell and cause the class switching, which we had mentioned earlier. So IgE is manufactured, which then attaches to the mast cell and the basophil. Now what happens with the viral infection is that even if a virus presents on a B cell, that will also get stimulated by IL-4 and 5 to produce IgE. And therefore, not only do viral infections increase with allergies, but allergies also increase with viral infections. So it's mutually detrimental to the patient. Now, the major player, the effector player for allergy are the mast cells. They have receptors called fractional crystalline epsilon R1 and R2. And this R1 receptor is the major player in this. Allergens bind to the IgE, bound to the mast cell. And that causes the mast cell to degranulate by increasing cyclic GMP. This causes the immediate phase of allergic reaction in which already preformed chemical mediators are released. Histamine, serotonin, heparin, tryptase. Histamine, you know what it functions. Tryptase causes the production of bradykinin and split of complement. And that starts the chemotaxis of the eosinophils. Now, in the late phase of allergy, new mediators are synthesized between 2 to 8 hours after allergy exposure. And this is the synthesis that causes cellular damage, tissue damage. The reason I'm going into the basis of allergy is that I want you to understand logically and scientifically where immunotherapy works. It's not just necessary to say I will give immunotherapy. You must know as a good doctor where in the cycle does immunotherapy work. Now again, in the late phase, the player is the mast cell. The mast cell, there are two types of actions that happen. One is at the level of the cell wall. In the cell wall, phospholipase A2 causes arachidonic acid to be created. And you know the arachidonic acid has two pathways, cyclooxygenase pathway producing prostaglandins and lipoxygenase pathway creating leukotriene B4, C4, D4. It also acts at the level of the nucleus, which causes through mRNA activation, it again causes the inflammatory cytokines IL-4, 5 and 13. Platelet aggregating factor and tumor necrosis factor. Now, tumor necrosis factor causes eotaxin production, which again increases eosinophil aggregation and TH2 aggregation, so that again the vicious cycle is started once again. So you see how the vicious cycle keeps increasing. Now, what are the leukotrienes? Leukotrienes are chemotactic as well as vasoactive amines, even more, 1,000 times more active than histamine. And remember one thing. We often talk about polyallergy, but monosensitization and monotherapy. Why? Because mast cells and basophils are not antigen specific and respond to more than one allergen. And therefore, polyallergic patients have an increase in what is known as the total allergic load. Eosinophils then degranulate, producing all these toxins. And one more statement that I want to make here, because that's very important for the immunotherapy to act, and that is the anaphylactoid reaction. That is, toll-like receptors 2, 4, and 9 cause rapid degranulation without even IgE binding. But even those are brought under control by your allergen-specific immunotherapy. So, as you know, in allergy, the lymphocyte response is Th2 instead of Th1. And these direct B lymphocytes to differentiate towards cells that produce IgE antibodies. And immune response exists as a balance between Th1 and Th2. So this balance, when it becomes IgE dominant, it's allergic, we need to modulate this IgG and IgE balance and return it towards the IgG balance bias. So initiation of immunotherapy causes an increase in IL-10, and this causes immunologic tolerance. It decreases histamine release through the allergen-stimulated basophil, downregulates mast cell activity by increasing the cyclic AMP within the mast cell, and reduces the uptake and processing of allergens. IL-10 is increased by allergic-specific immunotherapy. Now, why am I telling you so much in such great detail? Because I want you to know, often allergy diagnostics and immunotherapy is treated as homeopathy. It is not like homeopathy. There is a specific scientific basis to all of this, and I really need to emphasize this. And when IL-10 increases, for example, all of this causes increase in IgG4, and I'm not going into great detail here, but allergen-specific immune deviation from Th2 to Th1 cytokine profile because of increase in IL-10 and IL-12. And this is how it works. But it's very important to know that most effects of allergen-specific immunotherapy are thought to be allergen-specific rather than non-specific, and therefore accurate testing to identify the offending allergens in each patient is paramount importance for successful immunotherapy. So the next question that comes to you is, how do I choose the correct antigens and protocol? You can use the strength of the positive reaction on the skin prick test, the clinical history elucidating the degree of possible exposure, patient characteristics, as Sarika mentioned, these genetically allergic people are very, very strong. I mean, children of two parents are almost 60% more likely to develop allergy. The botanical interrelationships of pollen allergy groups. And one thing is very important, that all allergy groups should be administered separately and not in the same solution. So, selection of the mixture, there are two schools of thought. One is the American school of thought. Once you are confronted with 5, 6, 7, 8 allergens, the American school of thought is to desensitize against all of this. But the European school of thought says that large doses of allergen evoke a Th1 response and small doses of allergen evoke a Th2 response. And therefore, you must concentrate in giving few allergens and concentrated and the larger quantity of those few allergens in order to cause a proper clinically validated response. A quick mention on food allergy, although it's not in the scope of our discussion, is that slit can be used for food allergy also. It has been shown clinically to show good results for peanut, milk, rice, wheat, and egg allergies, along with oral immunotherapy. That is a topic which can be discussed differently, but do know that slit and oral immunotherapy can be used in food allergy also. It is also important to know that allergy immunotherapy, the evidence says that skit and slit are equally as effective, correctly administered, as the antihistamine desloratadine. And all the trials suggest that slit and skit have the same clinical effect, and they seem to have similar effect as pharmacological products, except in acute exacerbation. Now, immunotherapy also involves the build-up dose, the maintenance dose, the duration of immunotherapy, minimum 3 years. Now, many times you have to convince the patient that during immunotherapy, he is not or she is not going to get an immediate response. It has to take, it's going to take time. And the analogy I give them is that as if you're going to the gym, that you cannot become Salman Khan overnight. It's going to take time for the body to change. And you should give minimum 6 to 12 months for the effect of immunotherapy to start acting and continue for 3 years. So counseling is of paramount importance. Yes, immunotherapy is safe in children. I have given immunotherapy to from 4 years onwards. I'm sure Subir and Sarika will agree with me. And in fact, it's more effective in children and young adults. Immunotherapy is known to prevent the allergic march, which was so beautifully mentioned earlier. And yes, according to US FDA, you avoid immunotherapy in less than 5, but I'm doing it in children up to 4. Of course, there are contraindications to immunotherapy. It should not be given in the acute phase. Initial primary symptomatic treatment should be given. Immunotherapy is not a substitute for pharmacotherapy. Asthma refractory to treatment may require biologic treatment, so on and so forth. So immunotherapy is contraindicated. In severe asthma, it can only be used in mild, moderate, well-controlled asthma. Non-compliance of the patient is very, compliance is very, very important. Patients with immunologic disease, immunotherapy can be contraindicated. And of course, children less than 5 years of age. Now, evidence is that it works. Everybody has shown that sublingual is as effective as subcutaneous. So don't be afraid to provide sublingual immunotherapy. The idea today is to democratize allergy treatment. It is not the realm of only allergists. Each and every ENT surgeon should be able to treat basic allergy is my intent. And but of course, with correct training, with correct appropriate scientific preparation, so on and so forth. And it is proven that allergen immunotherapy has a disease modifying effect and not only reduces the symptoms, but helps stop the allergic march. The important thing to note is that till now, there have been no deaths or anaphylaxis, very few anaphylaxis with sublingual immunotherapy, more than 1 billion doses of sublingual immunotherapy. So it's even safer than paracetamol, for example. Slit again is equally effective, but the biggest problem is that awareness. There was an ISMA study in which I was a part in 2013, and only 20% of ENT specialists are using immunotherapy, but 80% of those are found to be clinically significant. So where are the other 80%? I think they all should log on and get going with immunotherapy. And long term, mild and moderate allergic rhinitis and asthma, immunotherapy can turn into the mainstay of treatment. So what are the advantages of immunotherapy? You improve the quality of your patients' lives. You improve your FES outcomes. That's very important. You have greater patient satisfaction. Reduce the use of antibiotics, antihistamines, steroids, particularly in children. Reduce the chance of chronicity and inflammation, and reduce the chronic low-grade inflammation to prevent allergic triggers, subsequent symptoms, frequent viral infection, and other problems. All the comparative effectiveness reviews have shown that the strength of evidence is high that sublingual immunotherapy reduces asthma symptoms and rhinitis symptoms. So statistically, 75% of patients require less than 3 topical and systemic steroids per year over a 3-year period. So I would think in terms of recommending allergy testing and immunotherapy on a long-term basis. And with that, I will come to the end of my talk. Thank you very much. I'll be more than happy to give more details should you choose to write to me. This is my email, ashim9066@yahoo.com.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ashim. That's a wonderful. You have nicely covered skin prick test and immunotherapy. We are running short of time. Dr. Sarika Verma, please be ready. There are questions in front of me. First question I am going to ask. Second question, Dr. Rupali, please be ready with that. Dr. Ramesh Rohiwal from Aurangabad wants to know how common is side effect like tachycardia with antihistamine nasal spray. Dr. Sarika. As you mentioned about azelastin, when we use azelastin nasal spray, does it cause tachycardia?
Clinically, I have never seen, sir.
All right, fine. Dr. Rupali?
Yes.
Ask the second question.
Yes. The next question is from Dr. Nitika Gupta. She is asking, Sarika ma'am, what mattress covers are you recommending as now allergopharma products are not available?
So there are multiple pharma, these allergen covers are available, dust mite proof covers. You can get them over Amazon, and you can also get them from your local stores. So I don't ever prescribe any particular brand. Various brands are available, and they start from 4,000 rupees and they go up to 10 to 11,000 rupees.
Dr. Vijayashri Gattani from Jodhpur wants to know, please elaborate on atopic March. What should be done for children who have childhood eczema, which is under control and no other symptoms are there? Kid has got only eczema. And Dr. Gattani wants to know, we have to stop allergy March. Please elaborate. Dr. Sarika.
Right. So allergy March is essentially, it gives us a very good idea that this person has an allergic issue, and if you don't treat it, they will get worse with passing time. Most children develop symptoms below the age of 5, and it typically presents with atopic dermatitis, that is rashes in the neck or skin creases, elbows, and then sometimes they can be all over the body. Most of the time, atopic dermatitis can be treated by the pediatric dermatologist or the pediatrician. But when they are sent to us, we do a skin prick test. In children, we do a smaller test. We don't do an elaborate test that we do for adults. Children usually eat about 10 to 12 things like milk, wheat, rice, egg, yeast. So we test for these 7-8 things in the foods and about 7-8 things in the air, like perennial pollen. And house dust mite is tested for all the children. And if there is a particular food that they're allergic to, we have to tell the parent to avoid it for 2 to 3 months. After eliminating it from the diet from 3 months, then we reintroduce one food per week in a cyclical manner of 48 hours. That means you stop, suppose the child is allergic to milk, you tell the parent to not give them milk, they can give them options of almond milk.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, Dr. Sarika. What he wanted to know, kid has got only eczema. Now, in allergy March, step-wise, everything develops. Rhinitis, then bronchitis. So, what should be done? I think he wants to know what should be done.
You have to treat the atopy and you have to treat it aggressively now.
Like,
when the child remains symptom-free because you have avoided a particular food, or if the child needed sublingual immunotherapy, you have given that, their allergic inflammation will come down and they are less likely to develop asthma or rhinitis as they grow up.
All right. Dr. Rupali, next question, please.
Next question is from Dr. Shilpa Nayak, Mumbai. She is asking, is there any commercially available intranasal anticholinergic in India?
Commercially available?
Anticholinergic in India. Intranasal anticholinergic.
Intranasal to nahi hai, but ipratropium comes in the form of a nebulizer respules, which a lot of these pulmonologists are using as a nebulizer, and that can be tried experimentally for non-allergic rhinitis not responding to intranasal corticosteroids.
I think there is a time that questions will start coming for Dr. Ashim. But yes, as he is also allergologist and has got a great interest in allergy, Dr. Ramesh Roywal again wants to know safety of montelukast in children. Dr. Ashim.
What has happened nowadays is that there is an FDA guideline that is recommending that montelukast causes neuropsychiatric effects in children as well as adults. So the use should be limited to a lower airway disease and for a short period of time.
Dr. Rupali?
This question is from Dr. Ishwin Preet Kaur. She's asking, which allergy testing do you prescribe? Panel testing or directly skin prick testing?
Dr. Ashim, it's for you.
Yeah, so basically I would choose, it depends. If it's a very small child, obviously skin prick testing is out, but skin prick testing is the preferred modality of treatment as of now. And if there is a polysensitized patient, then I would do a component testing.
All right. Dr. Dipti Pundle from Pune wants to know, how much is neti wash useful for allergic rhinitis patients? Can it be used regularly once the patient has stopped using intranasal corticosteroids? What should be the frequency for neti wash? Both panelists. Dr. Ashim, Dr. Sarika.
Well, I personally feel that neti wash is an excellent thing. You have to just make sure that the patient does not have an acute infection when using the neti wash, because that can spread to the sinuses. Having said that, you are mechanically degrading using the water to wash away all the chemotactic agents, and that's a very good thing. So it can be used almost indefinitely, according to me. Sarita, any other opinions?
So, sir, sometimes we use hypertonic saline in acute phase, and then it also helps reduce the size of the turbinates. And long term, we have to use isotonic saline.
Yeah, agree.
Okay, there's one question from Dr. Phukan from Guwahati. He's asking role of omalizumab and ziliotin in allergic rhinitis.
Okay, now as far as omalizumab is concerned, it is an IgE. It's an anti-IgE agent, right? So when you have a hyper IgE syndrome, that is where omalizumab can be used. As we saw in the pathway, omalizumab is important in two situations. One is grossly eosinophilic nasal polyposis recalcitrant to treatment, in which you've done multiple surgeries, but they are not associated with aspirin exacerbated respiratory disease. In those cases, omalizumab can be used. And the second scenario is that intractable the rhinitis, which is of allergic origin with a hyper IgE syndrome, that is where omalizumab can be used. But typically, I would not use it for rhinitis. I've only used it for asthma and recalcitrant polyposis.
Yes, sir.
Patient
is not for pure allergic rhinitis.
Never, never.
Condition that you mentioned, the indication for anti-IG is only asthma and, like sir said, recurrent nasal polyps, not eosinophilic dependent. So this is very important. Omalizumab should not be used for isolated allergic rhinitis alone, and it should not be used casually. It's a toxic drug.
It's only for asthma, intractable asthma, where steroids, they don't work.
Interrupts Subhiji, but I need to tell the viewers that omalizumab itself can create anaphylaxis sometimes.
You have to do the testing before that.
You have to give the treatment in the ICU setting.
Absolutely.
Yeah, correct. Dr. Sarika, specific question for you. Abhay Singh Deshmukh from Nagpur wants to know, Dr. Sarika ma'am, can we give nasal decongestants locally in lactating mother? Decongestants in lactating mother.
Lactating mother mein to koi issue nahi rehta hai, but in pregnant ladies, definitely no. But I personally don't like local decongestants, and I think that this over-the-counter local decongestants are really dangerous, and I think one of us should file a PIL saying that they cannot advertise that.
Next question, please. We are running short of time. I'm really sorry for that. We have to go a little fast. Dr. Rupali, please.
Jain from Bilwara is asking, how many courses of immunotherapy can be given?
Dr. Ashim, better for you.
Immunotherapy is it's not like a course. Typically what happens is that you have a build-up dose and a maintenance dose. So obviously, once you identify the allergens, you go into a build-up dose, depending on what are the allergens, so on and so forth. And you keep a maintenance dose on for a minimum period of 3 years. That is the bottom line, because for changing long-term treatment, I will say that if you have the possibility, go for 4 and even 5 years. And sometimes in those cases in which you have recurrent symptoms after an initially successful immunotherapy, even after 3 years, you can continue for 4 and 5 years. Because after all, it's better to use immunotherapy than steroids, according to me. Any discrepancy or opinion, Subhirji and Sarika?
No, it's okay, fine. Perfect. Next question from Shakib Khan.
I think that could be the last
question. I'm sorry, please.
I'll just add the last point to that. I think they were asking the courses, meaning you can run two simultaneous immunotherapy courses, like one for house dust mite and one for pollen. Yeah. They can go concurrently, but you have to give them on separate sets. You cannot mix dust mite with the fungus or pollen. And suppose the patient has significant allergies clinically also, you can give one that's go on 2 days, like Monday and Thursday, and the other on Tuesday, Friday.
Correct.
So concurrently, you can have at least two sets of immunotherapy that are going on.
Now, another question regarding maintaining the cold chain. Dr. Vijayashree Gattani from Jodhpur again wants to know, Dr. Ashim, what is the importance of the cold chain?
It depends on the manufacturer. There are certain manufacturers with stability, such as ALK of the US, and even our own people out here, a couple of companies that have given stabilities of up to 15 days at room temperature. Yes, you cannot store it in sunlight, but the idea behind maintaining the refrigeration is one and only one. That for 6 to 12 months, you should not keep it at room temperature.
I think both speakers have enlightened fantastically. Then you have covered allergy as a whole. Thank you so much. And we are running short of time. Dr. Rupali, I think we should conclude this first two sessions here. And over to Rupali for introduction of Dr. Deepak Haldipur. Dr. Rupali, please.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
I consider an extreme privilege to introduce a very tall and a towering personality, Dr. Haldipur sir. We all know him as the past AOI president, and he's the founder chairman of Trustwell Hospital Bengaluru, and today he's going to talk on nasal polyps. Over to you, Dr. Deepak sir.
So, Deepali, I think you also are very grateful to AOI.
Deepak's camera needs to come on.
Can you really see that I'm being heard now? My slides are there. 1 minute, I'll try to. I'm not finding my arrow, the cursor, Sameer. I can see the host has asked to start the video, but I'm not even. I started the audio, but for this, after I started the screen sharing, can they switch it on from there by any chance? Yes. Have I come on now?
Yes, Deepak, we can see you and we can see that you have shared the screen. Please start your presentation.
Yes, thank you. So, I would like to give personal thanks to Dr. Bharti and Sami Bhargav for starting the AYC.
Sir, your voice is very low. Dr. Deepak, sir.
Yeah. 1 minute. Now, can you hear me? Hello.
It's okay. We can continue.
Wait. Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. Loud and clear.
Yes.
So first, I would like to thank Sami Bhargav and Bharti because it was their brainchild, and the current AOI team who are doing a fantastic job of this AOI lecture series. It's an honor for me to be sharing on this platform, and today I would like to talk about the nasal polyposis. Too many academic events, so I'll try to keep my lecture very brief to the point. So I practice in Trustwell Hospital. Coming to nasal polyposis, as we are all aware, is an immunological disorder. And when I completed my post-graduation in 1990, I always felt that this was to be completely cleared only by surgery. And of late, I have realized that nasal polyposis, by and large, is a medical disease. And the ultimate solution to nasal polyposis, except probably the anthraconal polyps, the remaining polyps, would become totally a medical treatment in the years to come. Now, coming to the polyps, now broadly dividing them into anthraconal polyp, ethmoidal polyp, frontal sinus polyps, and sphenoidal polyps. In these, the ethmoidal polyps could be again divided into eosinophilic and non-eosinophilic. It is very, very important because if it is non-eosinophilic, then you tell the patient that the cure rate is going to be very good, whether it is surgery or medical treatment. And if it is eosinophilic, you're going to prepare the patient for multiple recurrences and running a chronic course. In other words, I would tell the patient that they have what is called as the asthma of the nose. Isolated frontal sinus polyps are pretty rare, and isolated sphenoidal polyps are also pretty rare. Many times these polyps occur in conjunction with the ethmoidal polyps. Coming to AC polyps. Now, AC polyps by and large are unilateral, and they are seen in younger people, and they usually occur due to, as we have studied in literature, the Bernoulli's phenomenon of the Poiseuille's law, because of a narrow ostium exerting a negative pressure on the walls of the maxillary sinus. The biggest problem about AC polyps in medical practice is, despite all the techniques being described, if the surgery is not done properly, they can be recurrent. So the investigations in the antrocoronal polyp, I would go for a diagnostic nasal endoscopy. And many times, the front portion may look polypoid, but somewhere in a hidden area, when you go through the endoscope, you can find something suspicious. Number two, we do a CT scan, a plain CT scan or a contrast CT scan. If the plain CT scan and the contrast shows bony erosion and different densities, then you have to be suspicious about a neoplasm. And the moment you develop a suspicion towards neoplasm, it is better to go for a biopsy in the outpatient setup and the histopathological evaluation. And number two, an MRI scan with a gadolinium contrast is invaluable in differentiating lesions like inverted papilloma or the other neoplasms and sinus malignancies. In all these patients with antrocoronal polyp, it is also important that you take the nasal secretions and send it for a culture sensitivity so that you try to treat the primary infection before taking up the case for surgery. Unlike the ethmoidal polyps, in antrocoronal polyp, a well-done proper surgery can really lead to very, very low recurrence rates. So here, what we would usually do, see, in antrocoronal polyp, the first important thing is planning the surgery. In the surgery, if you can notice my divided cursor here, the first step is to truncate the polyp at this level, take out this nasal portion, if it is big orally or nasally, and use it for histopathology. And then the primary step in almost all cases is doing a wide middle meatal antrostomy, which you can see in the top of the video here. And that is a small twig coming from the sphenopalatine artery anteriorly, which is spurting there. That can be easily controlled with a cautery. But what I want all of you to appreciate is that you need to create a very wide middle meatal antrostomy. That way you can look at the root of the attachment of the polyp. Suppose it is attached here. Then you remove that attachment, and most important, use a bipolar or a curved monopolar cautery to cauterize the area around this attachment so that the lymphatics are blocked. This is very important. Then, in cases where the attachment is on the posterior wall or the posterior part of the roof or the posterior part of the lateral wall or the medial wall, it is very easy to tackle the polyp through a good middle meatal antrostomy. Whenever the polyp has an attachment towards the anterior part of the lateral wall or the floor or the lower half of the medial wall or the entire anterior wall or the anterior part of the roof, it is sometimes difficult to reach the site of attachment. Then you have to go in for these approaches, namely my teacher, Dr. Madhavaya, used to do an inferior meatal antrostomy, which you have bought a little anterior nowadays, and we call it as a pre-lacrimal approach. Doing a pre-lacrimal approach and using a 40-degree debrider blade, you can, or a 60-degree debrider blade, gives you the access to remove the polyp from the difficult-to-access areas. If the polyp is coming from these areas, you can even use a canine fossa approach using a 40-degree blade through the canine fossa puncture, or you can go sublabially and do a mini Caldwell approach. This is what you can see here using an endoscope. This is especially, it is very, very useful in recurrent cases with multiple sessile attachments. You can see I've made an opening in the anterior wall of the sinus, putting in a 0 degree or a 30 degree telescope with a 0 degree blade or a 40 degree blade. You can actually remove the polyp completely. This approach should be reserved for multiple recurrences where the polyp has a sessile attachment covering almost all the walls of the maxillary sinus. In exceptionally difficult cases of multiple recurrences, you can even use the modified Denker's approach, though it would be a little overkill. But in an endoscopic medial maxillectomy, now we all know that if you give a sharp cut to the nasolacrimal duct, an epiphora can be avoided. So this approach can also be used in extremely rare cases. In even more rare cases where you have to really reach the anterior wall fully well without entering the wall from the sublabial approach, you can go transeptally. That is, you make a Kirian's incision on the contralateral nostril, elevate the mucosal flap, and then along the floor you make a small opening and put in your 60 degree diamond burr or a debrider blade, putting your endoscope through the ipsilateral nose, a 70 degree telescope, and you can remove the polyp. Generally, using one of these approaches nowadays, you can get a very good success rate in antroconal polyps. Coming to ethmoidal polyps, the ethmoidal polyps are always bilateral, and you can always see anosmia in that. You come up with nasal obstruction. They have a nasal voice, which is also rhinolalia, is also seen in huge antroconal polyps. They complain of the post-nasal drip.
Hey, now I can hear him on this. I can hear him on this.
Is it not okay? Hello?
Yes, sir. Continue.
Yeah. And then the post-nasal drip. And it's not the headache, but it is the heaviness of the head, which most of the patients with ethmoidal polyps. So, coming to the investigations in ethmoidal polyp, or rather, yeah.
Sorry to interrupt you. Can you speak a little louder? We are getting a... Can you raise your mic a little, yeah? No, now it is gone off.
Dr. Deepak, I think you have to hold mic near to your mouth. That's hanging down. That was the problem. Please try that.
Yeah.
Just hold it. No. That's don't make it on and off. Just hold it near your mouth.
Oh, now it's very, very.
Yes, testing, please. Deepak sir, please say hello. Hello. We'll be able to guide you whether we are listening or not.
So can you remove the earphones?
Can you hear me now?
Laptop mic.
Can Hello? You
hear me
now?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Oh, 1 minute. You can't hear me now? Just one sec. Hello?
Yeah, better, sir?
Yes, sir. Better?
I think maybe I'll hold the mic closer to me. Is it better now?
Yes, sir.
Perfect. Please go ahead, sir. Yeah. Thank you so much.
You can hear me now? Is it quite clear?
Yes,
quite clear, sir.
Okay.
Perfect, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sorry about that, yeah.
No problem, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah. Fine, sir. Go ahead.
I think
So the investigations, first thing is I would do a diagnostic nasal endoscopy where I would differentiate it from a malignancy or a neoplasm. Number two, I would also look for thick mucoid secretions, which are typical of polyposis, sometimes where I look for AFRS. Like in this CT scan, you can actually appreciate that you can see the double densities and things like this, which go more in favor of an AFRS. And whenever I have the slightest suspicion that I'm looking at a neoplasm or a malignancy, or I'm looking at an orbital involvement or something going towards the dura, I would jump and go ahead and do a MRI scan with contrast, which is the ultimate investigation. So plain CT evaluations are almost primitive now when you look at ethmoidal polyposis. Then I would take a biopsy. And in biopsy, what I would look for is an eosinophilic infiltration, number one. Number two, thickness of the basement membrane. Because if there is an eosinophilic infiltration, I tell the patient that this disease is difficult to treat. It is going to be a chronic problem and the patient can get repeated polyposis. And if the basement membrane thickening is there and there is evidence of fibrosis, then I tell the patient, no matter what I do, he is going to get moderate relief, and the remaining therapy probably will come from monoclonal antibodies or immunomodulators. The adjuvant investigations which help in polyposis, which you may not do routinely, but if you have a facility, you must do. Number one, doing the culture and sensitivity of the secretions, which is available in any laboratory. This gives you an idea about what preoperative antibiotic to use to bring down the infection and the congestion. Number two, you look for the serum IgE levels, because this again gives you an idea about the allergic component, the eosinophilic component of the disease. At the same time, which antibiotic is preferred to be used. Number three, you do the serum eosinophil count, again which hints you at the eosinophilic aspect of the disease. Check for the secretions where you look for eosinophils. If you do a C-reactive protein test, which is a simple test, it will give you an idea about your acute infections, where you can see that the CRP is raised. And you also estimate the vitamin D. Now, nowadays, we find a lot of people, especially in the urban setup, having vitamin D deficiency. If there is vitamin D deficiency, the steroid therapy that you gave will not work that well at all. So it is important to assess that, as well as finally keep a check on the thyroid hormones. So the associated risk factors you have to keep in mind before you think of surgery. Number one, both the masters, Sarika Verma, as well as Ashim Desai, just now spoke about allergy. Here, you need to do the general allergy workup, whatever they spoke in detail. And if you are looking at AFRS, then you have to even do a test for the allergy to fungus, because AFR is all about that. In the history, you have to rule out asthma, because if there is concurrent asthma with polyposis, then again recurrence rates are high, and you have to keep an AERD in mind in a small percentage of these patients. The aspirin exacerbated respiratory disorder, and where the treatment line totally differs, which I will discuss in a little more detail later. Smoking. Smoking definitely destroys the normal commensals in the nasal mucosa, which give immunity to the patient against these diseases. It also has various other disadvantages. So smoking definitely brings down the cure rates after your treatment. And then in patients with immunocompromised status, which could be primary immunodeficiency or immunodeficiency secondary to certain diseases. So you have these conditions like primary ciliary dyskinesia, you have hypogammaglobulinemia, and then secondary factors where patients have renal diseases, hepatic diseases, HIV, then patients who have received chemotherapy, patients with severe anemia. And these patients, definitely we need to address the issue by either using immunoglobulins. Macrolides work very well in immunocompromised patients. And then The way to diagnose an AERD is by assessing the urine leukotriene secretions or the urine leukotriene levels. And then we have to consider biofilms. All the good work that you have done can be spoiled by these biofilms. So in any patient post-surgically who keep on getting recurrent infections, we have to think of biofilms. The way to diagnose biofilms, one is by the confluent laser microscopy, which is not freely available. But the second thing is you can always do a tissue biopsy and then do a gram staining, which can show bacteria in large numbers. And number three, by doing repeated cultures of the nasal secretions. Now, biofilms, you have two organisms which cause biofilms very clearly. The commonest is the Staph aureus. And in very young children with nasal polyposis, where you suspect cystic fibrosis, the biofilms can be due to Pseudomonas. And again, the treatment of the biofilms, which I'll come to later, where you have a specific set of drugs. And then you have to look at osteitis. Now, osteitis is something which you can diagnose, one, by the radiological, especially the contrast CT studies, where you can clearly see a thickened bone. And again, the patients need to be told that these people require long-term steroid irrigations and long courses of low dose of macrolides, and then removing those osteitic bones repeatedly with mini debridements. But ultimately, this runs a stormy course. And for biofilms, of course, we use either tobramycin or mupirocin powder or manuka honey or xylitol and baby shampoos. Cystic fibrosis. Luckily rare, but you have to keep it in your mind. Very young children with nasal polyposis, cystic fibrosis is common. And cystic fibrosis can be diagnosed by two tests. One is the breath level nitrous oxide estimation. Number two, you can also diagnose it by estimating the sweat chloride over a period of 24 hours. Coming to preoperative antibiotics in nasal polyposis. Predominantly, you can think of two drugs. Number one, doxycycline. In the eosinophilic nasal polyposis, where the IgE levels and the eosinophilic levels are very high, doxycycline is a wonderful drug. You give it at 100 mg BD for 21 days. It has got an excellent anti-inflammatory effect. Now, coming to the macrolides, the drug of choice is clarithromycin. Usually, you use it in conditions where the IgE is low. Number two, it works very wonderfully in people who have biofilms. It also works wonderfully in the immunodeficiency disorders. And surprisingly, in those nasal polyposis, which are not responsive to steroids, the macrolides work wonderfully well. And the macrolides have certain disadvantages that they cannot be used in people with hepatic disorders. They cannot be used in people with renal disorders and other comorbidities where they're taking other drugs. They should not be used in the elderly beyond the age of 50. So it is much better to be used in people below 50 and who don't have other comorbidities. They work wonderfully well in select conditions as well. Coming to the medical treatment of the ethmoidal polyps. Oral steroids. The most preferred steroid nowadays is deflazocort, but you can also use simple prednisolone, methyl prednisolone, and other steroids as well. The topical steroids, the best one I would recommend is mometasone. Fluticasone furoate is also equally good. Budesonide is best reserved for postoperative irrigations. Now, coming to saline irrigations or douches. Now, in saline irrigations, there is always a controversy whether to use hypertonic saline or normal saline. When there is an extensive polypoidal disease, it is better to use hypertonic saline because of the osmotic effect. They tend to dehydrate these polyps, make them shrink. But post-operatively, when you operated for a polyp, it is better to use a normal saline or, you know, use ringer lactate solution. Even during surgery, nowadays it is preferred to stop using saline, because hypotonic saline, the disadvantage is at times it can interfere with the mucociliary activity. Allergy has to be treated. Vitamin D has to be corrected, because the moment you correct the vitamin D, the responsiveness to steroids gets better, steroid therapy. The mucosal secretions become more fluid. The mucociliary activity improves. The normal commensals or the bacteria which is present in the nasal mucosa, they become strengthened. So the local nasal immunity improves and the fighting of the disease becomes easier. Coming to monoclonal antibodies, these, according to me, are the future. The surgeons of my generation are fed up of operating repeatedly on these AFRS and these eosinophilic ethmoidal polyps, which keep on coming back in certain subset of patients. In these patients, omalizumab, mupolizumab, or dupilizumab, and now the benralizumab, out of which omali and mupoli are more preferable in the lower respiratory problems like asthma. Now the clearance for the nasal polyps, we have seen, happen best with the benralizumab and dupilizumab. Coming to the oral antifungal drugs, they have a limited value, especially itraconazole has very limited value, but I use it in four conditions. Number one, in patients with recurrent polyposis. Number two, patients who are very scared of the word surgery, they would like that to be postponed. And number three, in patients, some certain subset of patients in whom you cannot use corticosteroids because they have conditions like glaucoma or uncontrolled diabetes. And number four, for some reason, some patients I've seen when I've used these antifungal, especially itraconazole, the polyps have just vanished like butter. Only thing is, keep an eye on the liver function test. Do it whenever you have a doubt, and any change, always try to stay away from that. Coming to probiotics and prebiotics, they're also useful. And leukotriene antagonists have only one application, according to me, or maybe two applications. One, clearly in AERD, the aspirin evoked or exacerbated respiratory disorder, in which this is very useful. And number two, in patients who have concurrent allergic rhinitis, it can be used, but not for too long. Coming to the AERS, as I told, in the CT, you can see different densities. And when you do a biopsy and send it for the fungal stains, you can see the fungal being present there. The mucin is eosinophilic, and there's a type 1, hypersensitivity to fungus. This is usually seen in, not AERS, it's AFRS. That's a mistake in my slide. And the treatment or the surgery of choice when you decide to do a surgery in AFRS is, of course, the full house mess. As you can see here, the maxillary sinus is open. The sphenoid is open. The ethmoids are open. You can see the skull base here. You can see the frontal, which is open there. You can see the anterior artery, the supraorbital cell. So basically, you have to open up all the four sinuses and do a full house fess on both sides. If you have the latest equipment called the hydro debrider, it is very easy and useful to wash out the thick secretions. If you can't afford a hydro debrider, please use a 50 ml syringe to irrigate and ask your nurse or the assistant to use full force to wash the glue away. The oral steroids are also extremely useful when you give it for about 3 weeks postoperatively in AFRS conditions. You have to do nasal irrigations and constant nasal irrigations with butasonide solution has to be done in all cases of AFRS, and itraconazole in recalcitrant cases, and sometimes occasionally montelukast. But montelukast, according to me, the one and only indication I would still say is not AFRS, but AERD, aspirin evoked disease. Coming to the aspirin evoked exacerbation, in this we carry out a full house test. Xyluton is an excellent drug for AERD. Montelukast also works well. The diagnosis is done by the urinary leukotriene estimation. Also, this is seen in patients who have polyps with asthma and also in patients who got a history of hypersensitivity reaction to aspirin or other NSAIDs. The dietary restriction also helps in these patients with AERD, mainly to stay away from berries, to stay away from raisins and dry fruits like apricot, etc., which are rich in salicylates. Steroids work very well in AERD, and one most important thing is this aspirin desensitization. In patients in whom you are dead sure that you are treating a case of AERD, you have to practice aspirin desensitization. So you take the patient into an ICU kind of a setup because you should be fully geared up to treat an anaphylaxis. You start with a low dose of aspirin, you give a 30 milligram dose. If you are fortunate, the patient will develop a high reaction towards this 30 milligrams of aspirin. And if that happens, then you can, the good point is the moment a reaction occurs and you manage it, the next 2 to 3 days, this patient loses the ability to create or respond with a bigger reaction. Now use this golden period of 3 days and increase the dosage of aspirin from 30 to 75 and then 300 and you go up to 600. The moment your patient tolerates 600 milligrams, then it means you have achieved a good desensitization. Now you hold it on like that for a month or two and then gradually you can reduce it and finally come down to a dosage of about 100 or 75 and you have to give it lifelong. But believe me, in this subset of patients who have got this aspirin exacerbated respiratory disease, the aspirin desensitization, if practiced properly, works wonders and your recurrences really come down. Thank you very much for bearing with me and my audio. And I'm a computer illiterate, so I always struggle with my computers. I hope I could convey the message. And if there are any questions, I will always take it. And Rupali, I'm really overwhelmed with whatever you told about me or the way Samir treats me or the way all of you treat me. It's a real emotional moment for me. Thank you very much, Samir. You made my day.
Sir, thank you. Thank you, sir. You have elaborated everything very well. There's one question for you from Dr. Phukan. He has asked, what is the role of dupilumab as anti-polyp? Can it replace FES in future?
Absolutely. See, now benralizumab is even better. What is holding us is 2-3 things. Number one, the cost. Number two, the numbers. See, ultimately, we since even our first year PG days, we always get enamored by something new which comes in. But then we need to see how well is it going to work. But I am definitely convinced that the surgery that we are doing is not the answer. Now, I think Glaxo or some company has come out with benralizumab and they say the reports are even better with this. And as we get better and better, you know, monoclonal antibodies, which can block IL-4, IL-5 and IL-13 very well, I think ultimate solution will be medical. Fortunately, by the time me and Samir would have retired. Yeah.
So that was the only question for you.
Good. Yeah. Thank you very much. And thank you, Subir. And it was a real good lecture from Sarika, madam, as well as Ashim Desai. Thank you. I don't think we should hold anyone back for so long. Thank you so much.
Deepak, can you stop sharing screen? Yeah. So that we can see you.
Yeah. 1 minute. So I'll stop sharing the screen. Yeah. Yes.
Any more questions are there?
No, sir.
No. Thank you very much because I learned a lot of things from both of you.
Yes, this was... this was a very wonderful session. And as I said earlier, that allergic rhinitis is something that is not very well tackled in our medical colleges. And it is not a trivial disease. And thanks, Sarika and Ashim, for highlighting the fact that it is, because, you know, people feel it is a trivial disease. It is underdiagnosed. It is undertreated, incorrectly treated. And all our poor children who land up, who have this atopy, and they land up, you know, with the allergic marks. So thank you very much for highlighting that fact. And Ashim, we all know you as a wonderful otologist. And you. It was a very enlightening talk. And we learned a lot about skin prick tests and immunotherapy. Excellent. So I'm sure there are going to be a lot of questions that are going to follow up. And we are going to send it to your email box so that you can answer that for us.
Certainly. Thank you. It was a great pleasure, privilege to be with you, Sameer, as always.
And Deepak, as always, fantastic. The years of experience that you have are always put in all your talks. And that is what we want our junior as well as senior colleagues to take home from. So it was an excellent session. And thank you, Dr. Subir and Dr. Rupali, for this wonderful moderation and for extracting all the information that we required from our speakers today. And last but not the least, I would thank Dr. Reddy's for providing this platform and for us to be able to have this session every week. And we'll continue with this till at least the end of the year. So thank you very much once again to everybody. See you all next Wednesday when we have talks on the larynx. So it's going to be a talk on neck dissection and on neck space infections. So see you next Wednesday.
Lovely. It was a pleasure and privilege. Thank you so much, Sameer.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Sameer. Thank you, everybody. Thank you. Thank you.
And Deepak, take care. Bye.
Thank you. Okay. Bye-bye. Bye.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.